Carrie-Lam urges non-official EXCO members to play a greater role at formulating policies. Investigation report on the medical blunder at United Christian Hospital. And North Korea claims success with ICBM test launch. Hello, good evening. The chief executive stressed that strengthening ties between the legislative and executive branches of government is her top priority. Rachel Lang reports.
Day four in office, and Carrie Lam believes she's off to a good start. Before heading for her first Executive Council meeting as CE, Lam told reporters the transition from one administration to another had been smooth and successful. Lam also denied she was trying to distance herself from her predecessor, Leung Chun-ying, by seemingly undoing some of his policies, including her plan to actively consider reopening the area outside the government headquarters, commonly known as Civic Square, and to restart consultation on the abolition of the mandatory Provident Fund offsetting mechanism. She explained that it was only reasonable for each administration to take contrasting considerations and views. Lam, together with 16 unofficial members of the Executive Council, met the press after their first meeting. There were some new and familiar faces in the lineup, including former central banker Joseph Yam, former pan-democratic lawmaker Ronnie Tong, elderly commission head Lim Ching Choi, as well as DAB lawmaker Horst Jung. In front of her top advisors, Lam pledged to gain their full support before pushing ahead with policies. She added that non-official EXCO members are also being encouraged to exchange views with different principal officials during the early stages of policymaking.
I take it very seriously that I need to interact, and it covers also my principal officials, that we all need to interact more closely with non-official members of the Executive Council so that they can fully discharge their role to be our advisors in formulating these policies with a view to ensuring greater society acceptance of these government policy decisions.
She also assured the public that while seven lawmakers are also serving on the Executive Council, they're not there to simply rubber stamp government policies or help lobby for legislative support.
They are there to convey to us the views and sentiments of the Legislative Council members so that these views and opinions could also be taken on board at an early stage.
The CE also made it clear that improving the relationship between the executive and legislative branches is her administration's priority, and that she's very willing to take questions from lawmakers more often if they feel that's the best way to improve those ties. Rachel Lang, CBB News.
When Carrie Lam faces lawmakers' questions tomorrow, she's expected to announce plans to hand out $30,000 in subsidies for secondary school leavers. Anne-Marie Sin has details.
While she was campaigning for the top job, Carrie Lam pledged to add $5 billion to the government's education portfolio. And just a few days into her tenure as CE, she's expected to announce that measure when she faces lawmakers during her first question and answer session tomorrow. Some of the $5 billion will be used to fund a $30,000 subsidy to help secondary school leavers take up self-financed tertiary courses. Under the proposal, secondary students who have met the minimum requirement for university admission but can't secure a place on a government-funded college program can apply for the annual subsidy. The scheme could benefit more than 5,000 students every year. The new education chief played it safe by not preempting his birthday.
We should wait for wait for the chief executive to announce the package first.
The first batch of funding will reportedly be in the region of $3.6 to $3.9 billion. The money will also go towards raising the class-teacher ratio by providing around 2,000 contract teachers with permanent posts and making special education needs or SEN coordinators into regular positions. Lam is not expected to appropriate the $5 billion in one go, but will give priority to initiatives that can be implemented in the new academic year. The CEE also said she'll ask the Education Bureau to review the controversial Basic Competency Assessment, or BCA, which many parents have blamed for placing pressure on their kids as schools fail them for the test.
The next step is for the committee to continue to review the whole system, and then they will make some recommendations for the government to consider, and then we will decide the next step in the coming few months.
Anne Reesim, TVB News.
A hospital authority investigation panel says doctors at public hospitals feel rushed in treating their patients. It added this might be the reason behind a medical blunder at United Christian Hospital. Winner Wong reports.
A press briefing this afternoon to explain how a major medical blunder happened at United Christian Hospital. An investigation panel tasked with probing the incident said it was all down to doctors not being vigilant enough. Panel members said even though a pop-up window in the computer system reminded two doctors that a certain drug would pose risks to 10, they had probably forgotten by the time they wrote the prescription. Asked whether it's because doctors at public hospitals are overworked, the panel had this to say.
Workload cannot be used as an explanation for this incident. Okay, the main reason for this incident is insufficient level of vigilance. And this high degree of vigilance is especially critical in the face of a heavy workload.
43-year-old Tan Kwai Si's acute liver failure was brought to the public's attention earlier this year. Her teenage daughter pleaded for potential organ donors to come forward and save her dying mother. Tan ended up having to go through two liver transplants. It was revealed later that Tang's plight all began in July last year, when she was diagnosed with a kidney disease at United Christian Hospital in Kwintong. Doctors there prescribed her with high doses of steroids. Since Tang is also a hepatitis B carrier, she was at risk of liver failure, and doctors should have given her an antiviral drug as well. But both doctors seem to have neglected this, even with a pop-up window in the computer system reminding them about the risk. Tan's family was not aware of this blunder until she was later transferred to Queen Mary Hospital. Doctors there told the family about it. The hospital authority admitted today the two doctors responsible are still working at United Christian Hospital. When asked whether they would be punished, the authority only said they had already been dealt with. Went along TVB News.
North Korea said it successfully tested an intercontinental ballistic missile. If confirmed, it could be a potential game-changing development in Pyongyang's push to challenge Washington and its Asian allies. James Aiken reports.
The announcement of the launch of a newly developed ICBM called Hwasong-14 was made by state television. In typically heated rhetoric, North Korea called the launch a final step in creating a powerful nuclear state that can strike anywhere on Earth. The statement said the launch was ordered and supervised by leader Kim Jong-un. Reports say the rocket flew for almost 40 minutes over a distance of more than 900 kilometers before landing in the Sea of Japan. South Korea and the U.S. assessments earlier said it was an intermediate-range missile. But some experts say that such a trajectory could allow a weapon to hit the U.S. state of Alaska. Either way, which appeared to be North Korea's most successful missile test yet, and could be a major step forward in developing a nuclear-armed missile that can reach anywhere in the U.S.
The missiles didn't go any further than their other missiles, so what they say isn't the issue. The issue is they keep doing it over and over again. So, yes, it is a concern.
They can now hit continental United States territory. And, of course, ringing in all our ears is Donald Trump's assertion that this wouldn't happen. Well, it has. And, of course, everybody now wants to know what Donald Trump is going to do about it.
What Donald Trump did was tweet about it. Does this guy have anything better to do with his life? Trump tweeted. Trump added, perhaps China will put a heavy move on North Korea and end this nonsense once and for all. The Trump administration has been pushing Beijing to do more to push the North towards disarmament through economic pressure. During a phone call Sunday, the White House said Trump told President Xi Jinping that the U.S. was ready to act on its own against North Korea.
But in Beijing today, the foreign ministry once again called for calm and restraint, adding that China is opposed to Pyongyang violating United Nations Security Council resolutions. James Aiken, TVB News.
President Xi Jinping is wrapping up his visit to Moscow by holding talks with his Russian counterpart in a bid to strengthen bilateral ties. Jeff Tang reports.
China and Russia have agreed on the need for a simultaneous freezing of North Korea's missile and nuclear program, as well as large-scale military exercises by the United States and South Korea. That was the conclusion reached after Russian President Vladimir Putin held talks with visiting Chinese President Xi Jinping in the Kremlin. The two leaders also oversaw the signing of dozens of agreements to deepen bilateral cooperation in areas such as trade, energy, industry, and transport infrastructure. Earlier today, President Xi laid a wreath at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier at the Kremlin Wall, accompanied by Russian Deputy Foreign Minister Igor Mogilev. Yesterday, the President and First Lady Peng Liyuan were welcomed by Mogilev upon their landing in Moscow. In a prepared statement, Xi noted that the China-Russia Comprehensive Strategic Partnership of Coordination is at its best in history, sentiments echoed by Putin's Foreign Affairs Advisor Yuri Ushakov. He also pointed out that Beijing has engaged in aligning the Belt and Road Initiative with the Russian-led Eurasian Economic Union. The president was then received at the Kremlin by Putin. The two leaders spoke at length about their joint opposition to the grave threat posed by the US anti-missile system deployed in South Korea. Both Washington and Seoul have insisted that the THAAD missile system is solely aimed at defense against North Korean missiles. Beijing says the system's powerful radar can probe deep into its territory and would gravely harm the strategic security interests of China, Russia, and other countries in the region. At an informal dinner at the Kremlin last night, Xi and Putin also exchanged views on Syria and other issues relating to the Korean Peninsula, such as Pyongyang's nuclear and missile programs. After he leaves Russia, Xi will head to Germany, where he will also attend the 12th G20 summit in Hamburg on Friday and Saturday. Jeff Tang, TVB News.
A typhoon slammed into Japan today, grounding dozens of flights. Typhoon Nanmado made landfall around 8 this morning in Nagasaki Prefecture on the island of Kyushu. Packing winds of up to 144 kilometers an hour, it dropped 81 millimeters of rain in just 1 hour. By noon, it headed east towards Shikoku Island. Experts warn of landslides and flooding. In France, trust exchanges are in store for France now that Emmanuel Macron is president. That was his message as he laid out his 5-year agenda. Sonia Otero reports.
Macron arrived at the historic Palace of Versailles in a move that's kicking up controversy. He broke with tradition in convening an extraordinary joint session of parliament before his prime minister has won his first confidence vote. Still, Macron was afforded all the pomp and circumstance as he unveiled his political, security, and diplomatic priorities.
Vous soutiendrez ou vous combattrez selon vos convictions.
He began by vowing to lift France's state of emergency that's been in place since the country was hit by a terror attack in 2015. But he also promised to prevent new attacks at home while still maintaining France's military interventions against extremists abroad. In his bid to strengthen the European Union following Britain's vote to leave, he announced holding Europe-wide public conferences to reinvigorate the bloc. He also stressed European countries should work together to help refugees and strengthen borders against illegal migration. He made it clear French voters refuse to accept government corruption. This is why he plans to do away with a special court that currently has lawmakers judging those in government who commit crimes. Then he admonished the French media. Macron called for an end to the media witch hunts, aimed at destroying the reputations of those considered innocent until proven guilty. protesters in Paris slam Macron's call for a regal gathering. They claim the lavish ceremony cost the government 600,000 euros and called it proof of Macron's goal to run a presidential monarchy. Opposition lawmakers from three parties were also protesting. This included the far-left party of Jean-Luc Mélenchon, and all admitted they purposely boycotted Macron's speech. They compare Macron to Napoleon or the Roman king of the gods, Jupiter. Sonia Artero, TVB News.
And back locally, coliform bacteria was detected at a Starbucks shop in Causeway Bay. Its edible ice samples contained 12 times the guidelines level. The store under investigation is at Fashion Walk in Causeway Bay. A routine government test found ice samples with coliform bacteria exceeded the microbiological guidelines. This, the Center for Food Safety said, indicated unsanitary conditions or poor hygiene. But it did not mean consumption would lead to food poisoning. The shop has since stopped selling cold drinks with ice cubes. And finally, a barista in South Korea is recreating famous works of art. For about 68 Hong Kong dollars, 21-year-old Lee Kang-bin will create a famous painting that you can drink. He gets inspiration from artists like Vincent van Gogh. So how about a little cream with the scream? Or his recreation of The Starry Night. Lee is famous online with 160,000 followers on Instagram. And he kindly teaches his tricks of the trade to baristas around the world. But customers of his Cafe C in Seoul admit they'd much rather snap up pics of his work just because it's too beautiful to drink.
The world will be different if you're willing to share. It's a beautiful thing to share life by giving blood.
One blood study with rain tomorrow mixed with sunny intervals. The temperature will be about 30 degrees. And that's the news. Thanks for watching. Good night.